This week, we're getting a jump start on Election Day as we dissect those pesky questions you encounter on your ballot. Did you know beer is on the ballot? So is your cell phone. So is the fate of our public statues, term limits, and even the lines of the map. We track those issues and the week's top stories next.
Week in Review is made possible through the generous support of Dave and Jamie Cummings, Bob and Marlise Gourley, Haas and Wilkerson Insurance, the Courtney S. Turner Charitable Trust, John H. Mize, and Bank of America N.A. co-trustees. And by viewers like you. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Nick Haines. We've been receiving a lot of emails from you asking that we speed up our election coverage this year. Scott in Kansas City writes, on the Friday before a big election, you will break down the ballot. But since a lot of people will be voting early this year, can you do it earlier? Well, Scott, we have your back. In the next 30 minutes, we'll be pouring through all those ballot questions that sneak up and surprise you when you think you're just voting for president in your big offices like governor, senator, and member of Congress. Pouring through the ballot with us from 41 Action News, investigative reporter Kat Reid, from KCUR-FM, Mr. Up-to-Date Steve Kraske, from the Call newspaper, managing editor Eric Wesson, and from KMBC 9 News, chief political reporter Micheal Mahoney. Let's start with the issue that's getting the most attention, the most money, and is even attracting the attention of Hollywood celebrities. That's Amendment 3 in Missouri. Supporters say it will limit gifts to lawmakers, reduce how much money you can donate to a political campaign, and lets a bipartisan commission draw up the maps that decide the political boundaries of House and Senate districts. Now, that's what the supporters say it does. What do opponents say, Steve Kraske?
Well, this is really a battle, Nick, over redistricting. That's what Amendment 3 is all about. A couple of years ago, Missourians passed a big parcel of ethics measures that included redistricting. The whole idea 2 years ago was to make districts more competitive across the state of Missouri. This year, Republicans have mounted a comeback. They're worried about losing seats under this new Clean Missouri plan. So they have this Amendment 3 up there that would largely leave things the way they are when it comes to redistricting. 2 years ago, we passed a gift ban. We passed campaign restrictions. This amendment doesn't really change that a whole lot. This is really a fight over redistricting.
You know, I've heard the word deceptive used quite a lot. Critics say that. They worry voters won't understand what they're deciding. But could that same logic be used about Clean Missouri, which voters approved 2 years ago?
When it's passed, the Clean Missouri Initiative will eliminate almost all lobbyist gifts in the General Assembly, require that legislative records be open to the public, lower campaign contribution limits for state legislative candidates, require politicians to wait 2 years before becoming lobbyists, and ensure that district maps are drawn in a fair and independent way after the next census.
Now, that's one of the ads from 2 years ago. You'll note redistricting came in as item number 5, way behind other issues. Isn't that Governor Parson's argument that, in his words, it's never a bad thing to go back to voters a second time to make sure they understand what they're voting on, Kat?
Well, that is the argument that people have raised, and they've said that in the advertisement of Clean Missouri that redistricting wasn't necessarily listed as the first thing. But if you go back and look at the ballot language, redistricting actually was first on the actual ballot of Clean Missouri, whereas with Amendment 3, it's listed further down. And so the concern that Clean Missouri advocates have is that it's being hidden kind of in the ballot language. You have the first two things are banning lobbyist gifts, which were previously limited to $5, and lowering campaign contribution limits from $2,500 to $2,400. So that's why the advocates of Clean Missouri are saying that this Amendment 3 is a lot of smoke and mirrors.
Not everybody understood how we actually redistricted and put those boundaries together in the first place, Micheal. There was a bipartisan commission. There were just as many Republicans, just as many Democrats deciding those districts. So what was so unfair about that?
The people that are pushed Clean Missouri through say that when you take a look at statewide elections in Missouri, they're an awful lot closer than state representative and state Senate races, and that the boundaries in Missouri do not reflect how close the partisan split is between Democrats and Republicans. And so they say that having a state demographer take a look at this and draw districts that are more competitive is more reflective of the state's true political geography.
But now, you say more competitive, but Eric Wesson, is this really about making sure there are more Democratic representatives and senators in the state of Missouri?
They just want a fair shake. They don't want it to be where it suddenly becomes a completely Republican district. And I think that's what people have said that I've listened to.
I should point out also, Kat, Amendment 3 would change who is counted in each district. And according to the new language, that they will be eligible voters only. So no kids or non-citizens.
I was just going to say that it is an option in the language, but it's not a requirement. Voters don't have to be counted that way, but it does leave it open to do that.
So, Nick, just to point out one broad overarching point here as we wrap up this conversation. If you look at how Missourians have voted in recent elections, last three elections for president, for U.S. Senate, that kind of thing. What's going to surprise people is that that vote has largely balanced 50-50 between Democrats and Republicans. And yet the General Assembly is roughly two-thirds Republican right now. That was one of the genesises of Clean Missouri a couple of years ago. That's what those supporters want to change. Now, Amendment 3 that's up this year wants to keep status quo largely the way it is. It's up to the voters to decide how they want to go here. A vote yes on Amendment 3 mitigates, knocks out Clean Missouri. A vote against it keeps Clean Missouri in place and brings in this new way of redistricting.
What do you think about term limits? Did you know term limits are also on the ballot just over a week from now in Missouri? Just like in Kansas, the governor is restricted to serving only 2 4-year terms, and then they're out. Amendment 1 on the Missouri ballot would add the state auditor, the attorney general, the lieutenant governor and secretary of state to that 8-year maximum. Why now, Kat Reid, and what difference would that make?
Well, the argument is to create consistency amongst our statewide elected office, like the governor's office, which has term limits. And the argument is to try to prevent career politicians. But a lot of research with lawmakers has actually shown that when you institute term limits, you actually strengthen the relationship between lobbyists and lawmakers because the lobbyists have institutional knowledge. They've been there longer. And that's been the criticism of term limits, is that then you have lawmakers relying more on these lobbyists to understand the process to make some of the decisions.
Why would you want to vote no on this, Michael?
If you think Steve Kraske is the best lieutenant governor ever in the state of Missouri, you should have the right to elect him time after time after time, rather than having Lieutenant Governor Kraske automatically disqualified for running from that office after a second term. Jay Nixon, four terms, I believe, 16 years as AG. There was a guy, James Kirkpatrick, who had the job as Secretary of State of Missouri for, I think, 30 years. In general, most people in Missouri use these secondary executive offices, lieutenant governor, state treasurer, attorney general, for political stepping stones in Missouri. It's been happening for generations.
If you live in Kansas, beer is on the ballot. I thought that might get your attention. This is actually a question voters in Johnson County will decide. Did you know that in Johnson County, drinking establishments can't offer a pint of beer or a glass of wine without also selling food at the same time? And not just a few bar nuts and chips. The law says they have to bring in at least 30% of all of their revenue from food in order to stay open. So is it the burden on having to calculate these numbers every week, or even the burden of running a kitchen at all, that has prompted this change, Kat?
Yeah, the burden of really hitting the 30% is what's targeting this. Because if you look at craft beer now, the price has really gone up over the past 5 to 10 years. And so it's harder to meet the 30% threshold. Also, some of the brewers that my colleague Emma James interviewed said that it's difficult to partner with food trucks and other outside food vendors because of some of the hoops you have to jump through with this 30% requirement. So they say that eliminating it will really give them a level playing field, and would just make things a lot easier for them to do business in Johnson County.
Why would I want to vote no on this, Steve?
Well, you know, I think this is, if you want to keep restrictions on alcohol, Nick, I guess that's what the thinking is. All of this is just amazing to me. This is an old vestige of Kansas's dry laws. I mean, the state has struggled with alcohol ever since Carrie Nation was crashing into bar rooms across the state so many decades ago. Kansas is still sort of reconciling itself with these modern day alcohol rules. Most big counties have already made this change. Johnson County would just be coming to the table now, Nick.
Yeah, just to ratify on Steve's point for a second, Kansas went to liquor by the drink in 1986. Think about that.
In this extraordinary year, statues are coming down. Once honored monuments are being boxed up, carted off in the middle of the night, sometimes spray painted or even beheaded. If you live in Jackson County, you get to decide whether a statue of former President Andrew Jackson still deserves a place of honor outside the downtown courthouse and at a prominent spot just outside the Jackson County Courthouse in Independence. What happens if you vote yes? Eric, will county workers start carting it off right after Election Day?
Yeah, they'll cart it off. I don't know if it'll be right after Election Day, but yeah, it should more than likely should be moved probably within a month or so after they determine what they're going to do with it. If they're going to find some other place to set it up, maybe in Blue Springs or Lee Summit, put it up there, but it needs to come down. A lot of people feel that it needs to come down from in front of the courthouses, and it shouldn't be a landmark or one of the first things that you see when you go into that courthouse. So it'll come down, but it's just where they're going to put it at, that's a whole nother conversation.
Is there a plan for that, Kent?
There are a couple of ideas. There have been discussions about placing it in a museum or just moving it to another building within the county, as well as including a statue, or rather a plaque next to the statue, explaining the historical legacy of Andrew Jackson.
So it may not actually come down. They'll just put in a plaque, Mike?
I think this is a darn interesting vote. I don't think one should presume that the removal of these two statues is a done deal.
I agree.
There is going to be strong support, especially in Eastern Jackson County, to keep these statues where they're at. Now, if they do come down, I think the larger one from the downtown courthouse, and this is just me, I think it's going to end up at the Truman Library out in Independence. But I would not be locking in and placing a lot of money on the fact that these statues are going to be removed. I think it's going to be an interesting vote.
But still, Steve, if you vote no, could there still be the possibility of just adding the plaque that Kat was mentioning, perhaps, that gives a little bit more of the historical place that Andrew Jackson played?
Oh, sure. I think anything's a possibility if the statues remain in place, Nick. We'll see what happens. But I want to underscore Mike's point. I couldn't agree more. I think this vote is going to be surprisingly close, just for the reason Mike pointed out. Some of those outside of Kansas City districts, far more conservative, they're against this idea. And the county legislators who put this on the ballot will tell you they got phone call after phone call after phone call saying, do not take down these statues.
Now, while there's been renewed attention to street and monument names in Kansas City, over in Johnson County, Overland Park this week actually decided to rename a street after a police officer. Did you see that? Mike Mosher was shot and killed while trying to make an arrest in a hit-and-run case back in April. Could you imagine, Eric Wesson, during this time of tense cities outside of city halls and calls for reining in police funding, that such a street name would be named in Kansas City after a police officer?
Nothing surprises me. It would be a good tribute, and I'm sure that there are people that would support the idea, but it wouldn't surprise me if it happened, and it wouldn't surprise me if there was a large push to get it done, and it'll probably get done faster than naming a street after Martin Luther King.
Would you be willing to pay more on your cell phone bill each month? How about $1 a month more? That's what voters in Jackson County are being asked to do in the November election. That extra dollar a month would help pay for 911 service. Right now, that is funded by a special tax on landline phones, but as so many of us have now abandoned their landline phones, so the county wants to extend the tax on cell phones. While that may seem to make sense, some activists say now is not the time, and 911 needs to be reformed in the same way a reevaluation is taking place of police departments. Why, Eric Wesson?
Because if you call 911, they're going to put you on hold. I have had so many calls over the past 2 months, maybe, of people saying that they've had emergencies and they've called 911, and the first thing that happened was they put them on hold.
Kat Reid, if you voted no, would that mean those delays then would be even greater because there'd be less money for the system?
Well, in Missouri, we are the only state in the nation that doesn't require cell subscribers to help foot the bill for 911. So there has been talk about maybe not being able to make technological advances. There have been challenges in rural areas, especially of being able to triangulate locations when people make calls. But I think the argument people have about reforming the system is that 911 is kind of everyone's go-to, even when there are situations when 911 maybe isn't the resource you need to call. Sometimes you don't need to just immediately dial 911 for a mental health issue or a whole host of other issues. They think that we should reduce our reliance on dialing those three numbers.
Yeah, Nick, it's amazing in Missouri, even today in 2020, there are like 16 counties in the state that lack 911 service even for landlines. That's how far behind Missouri is right now. Because the state won't levy this tax, Missouri, very conservative state, the county's being forced to step in here. That's what's behind this initiative.
As we're talking about the police, I can't call this program Kansas City Week in Review without acknowledging that it became official this week. Kansas City, Missouri reporting the most homicides in the history of the city. Does breaking that statistical barrier make any difference this week? Did it lead to any new fixes, solutions, resignations, or radical changes, Eric?
You know, I think everybody's just at a loss on what to do and how to present it. Too many guns on the street, too many people with bad attitudes and inability to resolve conflict. I think that is what's going on. And it's something that is real prevalent in the Black community. And nobody has an answer to it.
But it is happening in so many other cities. I see Indianapolis just recently said they just broke their record for the year with more than 2 months to go, too, Steve.
Well, right. And I think what we have in our city right now is city government, the mayor, doing his level best to do something, to put a bandage on a problem that's so much bigger than really what he can do. And there is a sense that we know how to deal with this, but it would require the kinds of resources I think this community really hasn't begun to wrestle with in terms of jobs, programs, social services, social workers. If we really want to deal with this, we're looking at a big tax increase to invest heavily in these kinds of areas. We're not there yet. So what we have as a result is lots of little steps, changing ordinances, a few social workers and police departments. That's all good, but it's not going to wrestle this beast to the ground unless the community decides that's where we really want to go.
Micheal.
It is interesting and so sad to hear Eric's remarks on this, because there's a ton of sadness in the fact that this record gets broken and this has been baked into the cake, and everybody's known this was coming. And Steve's point there about other resources and other solutions is well taken. Let me add another one. I believe that the pandemic is a factor in this, in the fact that people are stressed out because they've lost jobs or they're not making the money they had before. There's a lot of stress in people's lives that all lead back to the things that Eric and Steve were talking about. And the fact that everybody is going on, well, we knew this was going to happen, speaks volumes about how serious this problem is and the need for the community of greater Kansas City, not just Kansas City, Missouri, to address this head on.
Okay, we're going to go back to the ballot. For quite some time now, there has been a drip, 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 drip of negative stories about how Clay County is run. Now, at the same time, you'll be voting for president. If you live in Clay County, you're also being asked to change the way your county government operates.
It's very well known regionally that we have a problem here.
On November 3rd, you're going to be asked to expand the three-person county commission to 7. The commissioners' salaries would be cut in half for the first time. They'd be subjected to term limits. Why would someone want to vote yes on this, Micheal Mahoney?
Why someone would vote yes to a change of the Constitution and the rules in Clay County? You don't have enough time for me to go through this. This is a three-member commission back from the old days of when this was a much smaller county, more rural. It's not an agricultural area anymore, and it needs to catch up with it.
How about voting? Why would you want to vote no then, Steve?
Well, you want to vote no. I don't know why you'd want to vote no. This county has had so many basic issues of everyday government, it's almost breathtaking, Nick. There, the county has become a poster child for lousy government in recent years.
Did you have a reason why somebody might want to vote no on this, Kat?
Yes. So the issue that people have raised is that it would change certain positions that are currently elected to make them appointed positions. There would be four that would change. That would be clerk and treasurer and a couple others, which the argument there was that they enact policy. They don't draft policy. So it makes sense to appoint them rather than elect. So there's a little bit of trade-off. You're adding more commissioners who will be elected, but you're decreasing some of the other elected officials and making them appointed. And that is one of the arguments against it that I've heard.
Now, just because you vote for a ballot question doesn't mean anything is going to change overnight. Case in point is Missouri's vote 2 years ago to legalize medical marijuana. Now, finally this week, after one delay after another, the first store to legally sell marijuana officially opened in our metro. These were the scenes from Lee's Summit outside that store called Fresh Green. Did you anticipate the long lines that we saw this week? When I first saw this footage, I thought they were actually waiting to vote, Derek Wesson.
Yeah, I figured the line would be long, but I didn't think it was going to be that long. I had a friend of mine that went out there and said they waited in line for 4 hours, and they were limiting the number of people coming into the store because of the social distancing and those things.
You know, I would take the opposite point on this, is that Missouri has implemented medical marijuana relatively quickly. Now, they have had some
2 years problems. That was quick.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. It is. Look around the rest of the country.
Cat.
Not bad.
The state had to spend at least $1.3 million on legal fees, defending itself against those who were denied applications and argued that the process was unfair, or maybe had some glitches. So there has been a major price to pay in the rollout of this. But briefly, let's touch on the amount of money that's going to Missouri veterans. You know, there was a 4% tax, and already $2.1 million has been sent to the Missouri Veterans Commission. That's just from the licensing and registration fees. Before next, you know, the sales will factor in and go to that fund.
As we look at some of the week's other top headlines, 20 years ago this week, Missouri was burying its governor after a plane crash kills Mel Carnahan.
So when will this deep ache I feel go away?
We'll miss you, Mel. We'll try to take up the slack, but we'll not have another one like you.
President Bill Clinton there at the funeral. Does that tragedy still have a ripple effect in Missouri today, Steve Kraske?
Oh, absolutely, Nick. And I did a show this week on KCUR looking back at this. And in the immediate aftermath of the plane crash, Missouri began to swing Republican, and Republican in a very significant way. The General Assembly flipped from Democratic control for what had been for decades to Republican control, and it's remained that way ever since. Carnahan people will argue the point, but Governor Carnahan was a fairly progressive Democrat, and that didn't sit well with a lot of Republicans, and the state swung as a result.
Michael.
Plane crashes, two of them, have affected Missouri's political history in a dramatic fashion. 1976, Jerry Litton died on the night he won the primary to run for the Senate. On the evening that Mel Carnahan died, I think he was trailing. I think he would have lost that race. Ashcroft lost to a dead man in his Senate career. But weeks after that, President George W. Bush, Bush 43, named him as his first attorney general. Yeah. And it is striking, I think, that two plane crashes in two different political generations have had the impact that it's had on Missouri.
Now, one lesson paying attention in this would be to the role of lieutenant governor on the death of Carnahan. Roger Wilson was largely unknown outside Jefferson City, became the state's top official. That would repeat 2 years ago when Mike Parson got to the top spot in Missouri politics, only after scandal play Derek Greitens resigned as governor. Are you paying attention this year to who's running for lieutenant governor? Actually, it's someone very well known to us here. It's the woman who wanted to be mayor of Kansas City, former councilwoman Alicia Kennedy. She's running against a former Republican state senator who was appointed lieutenant governor by Mike Parson when he became governor. It's an interesting matchup, and as Kennedy is an attorney who made crime and justice such a big part of her platform, is running for lieutenant governor an odd fit for her, Kat Reid?
Well, actually, in an interview with KCUR's Lisa Rodriguez, Kennedy said that she was actually asked to step up and run for this position. She's tried to tie it to her kind of criminal and justice platform by talking about the boards to which the lieutenant governor is appointed, to which, you know, he or she would serve on. And one of them is on children's issues is the main focus. So that would go into foster care and children's services, which all do align with the root causes of crime and the issues of justice. So I think that that's the way she's been trying to thread that needle.
You know, another connection to the Carnahan tragedy is the man he was waging a campaign against at the time of his death is also on the ballot in a way. John Ashcroft's son, Jay, is the Missouri Secretary of State. He's now running against Yinka Feletti, a St. Louis area attorney who came here as a child from Nigeria, went on to West Point and served 6 years of active duty, including two deployments in Kuwait. The Missouri Secretary of State is the state's chief elections officer. Is this matchup a referendum on how elections are being conducted in Missouri, or is there more to it than that, Steve?
I think maybe just a little bit, Nick. You know, Missouri still lacks so many of the conveniences that our Kansas brothers and sisters have, advanced voting, that kind of thing. I think there's a level of frustration out there among some people. But, you know, let's face it, it's Secretary of State, Nick. People don't pay a whole lot of attention to it. The Ashcroft name still resonates pretty strongly in the state of Missouri.
Is there more to that race than just the conducting of elections, Eric Wesson?
I think it is the elections. I think that's the key. And another thing that I hear people talk about too, and I've experienced it myself, is the state's website for Secretary of State. That's a pretty complicated process. If you're a business owner and you're just trying to renew your business license and do those things, especially trying to see if you're still registered to vote.
If there had been problems during the Missouri presidential primary for the Democrats, if there had been problems during the local elections, they got pushed back from April to June. If there had been problems with the August primary, and there were not substantial problems, the elections would be a lot bigger issue in this race.
And that is all the time we have. Thank you to Kat Reid from 41 Action News for dissecting the ballot with us, along with the Call's Eric Wesson, KNBC 9 News chief political reporter Micheal Mahoney, and keeping you up to date weekdays at 9 on KCUR-FM, Steve Kraske. Next week, we'll be taking a look at what to expect on Election Day on both sides of state line. And will the dueling doctors be with us? We've been negotiating for months with Barbara Beaulieu and Roger Marshall. Will they debate? Beaulieu will be here. Will Marshall? Find out next week. From all of us here at Kansas City PBS, keep calm and carry on.